No Jumper, coolest podcast in the world. And today, we're sitting down for a very interesting dive.
This was designed to get the most eyeballs on it as possible.
Hey guys, guess who I'm shooting with today?
These people have an agenda, and it's up to us to understand what the agenda is.
You even went so far as to Photoshop a picture of his kids with bruises on them. Not gonna give that ugly, worthless specimen anything.
The No Jumper podcast has long been a well-known and well-established name online, representing a beacon of hip-hop and extreme sports culture, and a platform for many up-and-coming names to emerge. While the No Jumper YouTube channel was created 12 years ago, in 2012, the self-professed coolest podcast in the world didn't see its first episode until 2015, and the channel initially uploaded BMX content, often involving the creator of the brand, Adam22.
Hey, what's going on? This is Adam22, aka your girlfriend's favorite BMX blogger.
Since then, the brand has become massive, boasting 4.7 million subscribers on YouTube, 274,000 monthly listeners on Spotify, and almost 2 billion channel views. It went viral for insane moments and popular guests, including fights, robberies, and more. And has reached widespread success with interviews, news, vlogs, and other forms of media surrounding rap culture, extreme sports, and adult content. With this expansion has come a wide variety of new guests and interviewees, ranging from mainstream celebrities to underground musicians and internet personalities. The rise of No Jumper has not been without its fair share of controversies, involving the culture surrounding the show, those behind its production, namely Adam22, and its guests. And these controversies vary in seriousness, from instances of racism, homophobia, and pretty much every other ism you can think of, to allegations as serious as making false abuse accusations, grooming,
you are a straight pedo,
and being a deep cover state plant in a seemingly perpetual fight against gay white supremacy. It has become characterized by self-flagellation, depravity, and profiting off of morally bankrupt behaviors. Some of these names you've heard before, and some you may soon become aware of, but all of them share two things: their controversial and abhorrent behavior, and their presence on the coolest podcast in the world. These are the No Jumper Degenerates. Before talking about some of the more interesting degenerate guests that have appeared on the podcast, it is necessary to get some background on the host of many episodes and the creator of the No Jumper brand, Adam22, as the degenerate and morally bankrupt nature of his behavior has clearly translated to the choices of and conversations with guests the podcast centers around. Adam22, also known as Adam Grandmason, was born on November 24, 1983, and grew up in Nashua, New Hampshire. He expressed an interest in hardcore music and extreme sports since he was young, which eventually culminated in the formation of the No Jumper brand. Before that, though, he would create a blog surrounding BMX culture, known as The Come Up.
Hey, what's going on? This is Adam22 of thecomeup.com.
This would also result in his founding of On Some Shit, an online BMX clothing store that would eventually have a brick-and-mortar location. And following a move to LA, he became more involved in the hip-hop community, becoming a sort of e-celebrity.
With this shop even, it's like, oh, well, this is our opportunity for LA, which is probably the biggest BMX market in the world, for us to actually project BMX the right way.
His growing interest in hip-hop led him to co-found the No Jumper Tumblr page, and following a dip in popularity of On Some Shit and a move to Skid Row, he began to interview BMX personalities and eventually transitioned to interviewing rappers, which led to a skyrocket in engagement. Following this, the No Jumper podcast was truly established.
Then I started to, you know, do vlogs and podcasts that went outside of BMX. The Xavier Wolf one was the first one that really got the ball rolling, and that was still on the BMX channel, and it didn't feel like we were doing anything like outside of BMX because he was like riding with us at that time. But yeah, I know, it was just like the opportunities that started to like blossom up and everything from doing the BMX interviews sort of led me in the direction of doing a lot of stuff outside of BMX.
Adam used his connections to find more and more guests and became famous for conversational interviews and interviewing underground rappers, especially those who saw later success. Now that we've established a brief history, we can talk about some of his controversies and degenerate behavior. Adam 22 has long been the center of scrutiny for his focus on gruesome details during interviews, doing what some see as glorifying violent criminals.
So were you raised around seeing all this crazy shit going on all around you growing up, or what was that like?
Yeah, I seen everything.
Give me some examples of some wild shit.
I can't give you no example of wild shit I see.
Really?
And his alleged relationships with and abuse of underage girls, and most recently, the nature of his relationship with his wife and their work in the adult content industry. The first mentioned controversy persisted despite complaints, and Adam continued to have similar guests on to recount violent details and stories about going to jail. Some have complained that he is taking advantage of black or hip-hop culture despite not being a part of it.
That was it?
Not funny to me.
I mean, that's
not at all.
It's an important clip. It's an important thing you talk
about.
But
this is a microcosm of this business and what goes on and how some people look at black artists, black lives. Like, come on, Adam, you got a bigger responsibility than this.
And others have even claimed that he has used that culture to propagate racism by platforming guests such as Nick Fuentes, a notorious commentator and provocateur that has exhibited pretty much every imaginable ism and phobia out there.
And today, me, AD, and Flocka are going to be having a conversation with probably the most controversial person that we're ever going to talk to, apparently. Nick Fuentes, how you doing?
As well as Richard Spencer, a former neo-Nazi.
I have arranged a conversation, probably like the best shot that I could have at getting canceled, if I had to really guess. We got Richard Spencer in the building.
The allegations regarding his degenerate treatment of underage girls centers around his posts on the B9 board, some of which detail a brief relationship he had with a girl named Desiree, whom he met when he was 23 years old and she was 16. He claims that while they flirted at that time, they didn't engage in sexual activity until she was of legal age. Though with quotes like, "If statutory rape is wrong, I don't want to be right," and "She was 16, but come on man, look at her," it's safe to assume that that probably wasn't due to his moral compass. The post also contains several other gems, including the constant juxtaposition of Adams claiming that she was dumb, she is 19 and female, so to an extent, she's an absolute idiot, and air of contempt for women, regarding them basically as sex toys, while simultaneously writing an account of flying to Canada to be with her and lasting, quote, at most 1 minute when they had sex. Anyway, the resurfacing of this post was accompanied by several accusations of rape by someone identified as D, which many assume was Desiree, as well as someone else named Jane, though evidence centering around these instances is lacking. Though Adam seems to remain relatively unscathed by these, it is worth noting that No Jumper's partnership with Atlantic Records was ended following these events. These revelations would again resurface when the Perv Busters from Instagram confronted Adam 22, who, may I just add, implemented such verbal acumen and nuance when approaching the topic that I have to pay my respects.
I do think there's a possibility for anybody to change.
Anybody? Yeah, yeah. So
in terms of how we receive their change,
yeah.
That's different.
So you're telling me that an ex-Nazi can change and we could forget about all the stuff that they said within their hearts, all the stuff that they thought about, all the stuff that they...
I forget, though.
Okay, so now, can somebody be an ex-pedophile? So what's up with these allegations of Adam fucking with a 16-year-old?
Nah, come on, bro. We can't do that, man.
What
come
you mean
on,
we can't
man.
Do that?
Come on,
but
bro.
Wait.
Mwah. Beautiful. And Lil Pump, who he toured with previously, also accused him of sleeping with 16-year-old girls.
Fucking girls my age, right? Adam was fucking girls that was the same age as me when I was 16. Like, what's wrong with you, bro? You are a straight pedo.
It goes without saying that everything cited here is just allegations and hasn't been proven. Now, moving on to possibly the most covered and viral controversy of Adam's career, one that surfaced quite recently. Adam's Wikipedia page, though lacking a lot of information, only has three sections, being the come up slash on some shit, no jumper, and pornography. Now, what could possibly have transpired to earn this title? Well, following his wife Lena's channel reaching 1 million subscribers, she and Adam filmed and posted their first adult tape. This was followed by a threesome with Trisha Paytas while Lena was pregnant. Wow. Plug Talk, a new show, became their avenue for discussing this type of content and gained widespread popularity. But the biggest and most notable moment of this descent into madness was, of course...
Hey guys, guess who I'm shooting with today? It's finally happening!
Let's talk about the elf in the room, or the BBC in the room.
King Ding-a-ling,
He would wear a Weezer shirt. Following Adam's wife sleeping with Jason Love, there was a massive blow-up on Twitter, and the way he responded to people clowning on him was probably less than ideal. Aside from remarks about how it takes a real man to let your wife sleep with another dude, he actually had an interview with her soon after, in which there were many mentions of how she is recovering from a bigger dick.
People probably want to know, what is it hard to go back to a, you know, reasonably sized white penis after dealing with a baby arm? Is it upsetting?
No.
Is it hard to go back to regular life?
Because nobody wants like an outrageously large penis all the time.
Right.
It wasn't hard to come back to your dick.
And returning to the pre-BBC size, Adam attempted to roll with this, constantly being self-deprecating and making posts arguing with people about how he's a real strong man, but predictably, his reputation was not helped by this. A more recent example of leaning into the depravity is an instance of Adam sharing his wife with someone named Lil D, and apparently sharing a fist bump with this fine gentleman during their session. Great. The reason Lil D found himself in this privileged situation was that he had won their show for the love of Lena, in which 10 men competed to sleep with her.
My name is Adam22, and I co-own Plug Talk with my lovely wife. We interview a different girl every week.
And then we f*** them at the end. But we've only ever done it with other women.
So we've arranged this whole challenge to find the perfect guy to be our first ever boy-boy-girl threesome.
Signifying a complete dive into the self-deprecating spectacle, as if that wasn't extremely obvious already. Aside from all this degeneracy, Adam is also known for having gang members and other criminals on the show and asking them constant questions about their criminal pasts, as well as, with any controversial guest, seeming to have a complete lack of moral qualms during their stories and misdeeds. Though the channel has evolved to have many shows that no longer involve Adam personally, he is an integral part of the brand, and acknowledging his degeneracy can shed some light on the nature of other guests and their conversations, as well as how so many degenerates have come onto the show. This brings us to the false accuser, blackface wearer, and Toronto rapper known as Lady SB. Lady SB, or as she is known by her few loyal online detractors, Lady BS, owned, is a 24-year-old underground Portuguese musician from Toronto, Canada, though she might have you believe something different about her ethnicity. And when I say underground, I mean it. Maybe Adam's instincts are fading. Anyway, many have pointed out that she seems to have had a sort of transformation, noticeably appearing to have a much darker complexion than in pictures from a few years ago. Not only that, but Portuguese people are not exactly known for their tolerant views about black people, and there have been instances from the past indicating Lady SB's family and perhaps herself shared these same sentiments. In the past, she has tweeted lamenting about being Portuguese because her father lectures her about having pretes, or blacks, in her house. Though when recounting these revelations, she uses a notable combination of crying and laughing emojis. Additionally, there are screenshots of her pleading for someone to explain something to her because she's not fucking black, which certainly contradicts with the physical transformation she seems to have had. Many speculate that these efforts to appear more black are to fit in more with the culture, or to sling slurs. In the podcast, following a cringeworthy segment about Lady SB being over her hoe phase,
I felt like I'm doing too much at this point, you know?
You were just giving it up too easy? Or too frequently?
Yeah.
Despite wearing an outfit that quite literally had to be blurred, and half the segments of the interview being about sex and how she's always been sexual, they discuss an incident in which she was pulled over for possession of several firearms.
I was charged in 2020 with 13 counts of like guns and like loaded weapons and all types of
stuff. But you just got pulled over and that was in the car, right?
Yeah, but it was our stuff.
I'm guessing and it wasn't like yours.
Of course, it was ours.
No.
So it was your man's? Part of it.
Cause me and you know.
This comes directly after she expresses her pride in dating gangsters. And she remains adamant that the firearms were partly hers, as if it proves how hard she is.
What kind of dudes are you with? Ball players, gangsters, rappers?
Yeah.
Gangsters.
Authors?
I love gangsters.
She also claims that she was charged with 13 counts of possessing the weapons to add to the street cred, as they may call it, which seems to be a gross over-exaggeration. She also seems to imply that they were on their way to do something with the weapons, which even the hosts seem to believe is a blatant lie.
We were like going somewhere. You know what I'm trying to say?
Okay.
Going somewhere.
And you need to have like 15 guns on you to go there?
But of course, she beat the charges because someone took the fall for her. She truly has all those gangster connections. SB must stand for Syndicate Boss. Anyway, this obviously false vibe for attention sparked an argument between her and Sharp, Adam's co-host, while Adam just kind of sits there.
Hell nah, they better take it. Hell nah.
I'm saying they put the charge.
Hell yeah, they better take it.
What are you talking about? No, listen.
There's three men in the car. Why would I take the charge?
Wait, they hit you with it. Let's say they hit you with a big gangster, right?
Hit me with what?
They hit you with the charge for everything that's in the car.
Everyone in the car got charged, the same charge.
But you saying to me,
you never been charged before with other people?
But if they had to make you go lay down,
what Coach is,
you go lay down behind it, we just slang for.
No one can talk about going down behind it.
That's slang terminology, you know.
Her argument is basically that she's too important for her gangster boyfriends to let her go to jail. What a real gangster moment. But the most heinous controversy by far she is involved in centers around her apparent false accusations against her ex-boyfriend, which are covered in her interview on No Jumper.
This clip went viral recently of you basically saying that you had previously accused one of your dudes of abusing his kids, and you even went so far as to Photoshop a picture of his kids with bruises on them, and you basically became like the villain of Instagram and Twitter.
This follows a clip of her going viral in which she claims to have used AI to fake bruises and make her accusations more convincing, and to have almost gotten her ex's children taken away as well.
I called like child services on this one. I called child services on my ex. Because he pissed me off, and then I was like, yeah, I'm done with this person, whatever, like, you know, cheater, fucking piece of shit, lies about dumb shit. He had kids. I called child services on his ass, and I, like, fabricated everything and, like, said certain things, and they, like, went to the door, and, like, there was a whole process. Like, I don't even know if the children's aid worker still visits them, but she probably does, because what I said, like, the way I AI'd that shit, you know, like, real AI shit, like, fake bruises type shit.
Be careful, fellas. Yeah.
Yeah. Pretty crazy.
Of course, this instance was used in the title to draw clicks for her interview, and a portion of the episode was dedicated to covering it. In this portion, she claims that, get this, her PR team had her say this, and while she was rehearsing it, they were actually recording, and then released the footage despite her protests.
Right? So we got on that Real Toronto podcast, and my PR team was like, oh, let's say this, let's just rehearse it. The cameras will be off, whatever. So dude had the cameras on and caught me saying that, and then I was like, you know what, like, it's a bit much, let's not include that. I even have messages of him saying, like, don't put that up.
Now, there are so many ways to pick apart this story that I don't even know where to start. It's clear that she has absolutely no idea what she's talking about here. To their credit, Adam and Sharp don't really seem to believe this story either, but, you know, baby steps.
I don't know if I buy it though. I think there's a guy out there who lost his kids.
I can put 20K up.
You
veered off
on some other shit. Then you must have lied.
I told you it was a PR. My PR team.
Find him.
When you find him, come talk to me.
Talking about some imaginary man with imaginary kids. I don't get it. So who am I looking for here?
She then expresses that she thinks the goal was to kickstart her rap career, implying that she lied about false abuse allegations as a PR stunt. I really am not sure what to make of this. On one hand, she lies about being a gangster and getting off of like 30 years in jail because she's too important, and she also pretends to be black. But on the other hand, the clip sounds pretty authentic, and what could possibly be the motivation to lie about something so terrible that even Adam22 and company would object? I could honestly see both, but she's still a degenerate either way, because either she's lying or she's lying about lying. It seems to me that she's a compulsive liar, constantly trying to say things that will get her more attention, but is too dumb to make them sound realistic, and looking at her view counts and streams, I don't think that's going to start working anytime soon. But if you think she's living a lie, you haven't seen anything yet. There is someone whose entire identity is questioned, and whose delusions and conspiracy theories are so far-fetched that it's almost more realistic that he's a government plant. Let's move on to Tariq Nasheed. Tariq Allah Nasheed, or Marcus Sanders, has been interviewed on the No Jumper podcast several times, and as a returner, there's that much more degenerate content to go through. He is 49 years old, though he claimed himself as 78 on the podcast. And what is it with these old dudes not wanting to admit their age? Yeah, whatever. He is known for his wild conspiracy theories and documentaries. Namely, the overarching theory that the gay white supremacists are plotting to turn black people gay and stop them from reproducing, as well as his fire raps made under the name K-Flex, such as Training Hoes, My Pistol Goes, and the classic Wash Yo Ass. He has many interesting takes on racism, and while being notably against race mixing and hateful towards certain groups, claims that black people cannot be racist. His instances of racism and homophobia are too common to count, but suffice to say, he is fighting against the power of the gay white supremacist regime to counteract the newest threat to black masculinity. That would be the existence of gay people. He has 8 documentaries, 5 of which fit into the Hidden Colors series, in which Tariq makes many unsubstantiated claims about different faiths and cultural advancements, as well as important innovations being invented by black people. That many historically figures were actually black, such as the Buddha, and that the media promotes homosexuality in order to turn black people gay. Additionally, he claims that Christianity is an instrument of this same oppression. Hilariously, Nasheed claims on No Jumper that he was contacted by Homeland Security themselves to inform him that many bootleg copies of Hidden Colors were found on a Chinese ship.
I saw it was a real problem when I got a call about 5 years ago from Homeland Security.
Yeah.
And they told me they intercepted a shipment of a bunch of bootleg movies.
Yeah.
From like Warner Brothers and a whole bunch of people coming from China.
Wow.
And a lot of my movies were on there. They were asking me, did I know anything about it? Yeah. Like, you know, there's a bunch of bootleg copies of your films on this ship that we intercepted. I'm like, well, shit.
And therefore, it didn't make as much money as it would have. I'm sure that with how well-received his documentaries have been, this is definitely the case. Along with Star Wars and Infinity War, you just know people are dying to get their hands on Hidden Colors. Additionally, another documentary, Buck Breaking, documents incidents of sodomy and gay sex in times of slavery, with many details and illustrations, which I'm sure make for a very pleasurable viewing experience, earning it a 2.6 out of 10 rating on IMDb. This solidifies his stance that white people are oppressing African Americans through decades and centuries of forcing homosexuality onto them.
We need resources in labor, we need resources in politics, we need resources in medical, we need resources in so many things, but they ignore that and they put millions and even billions of dollars to tell us that you need to really embrace your LGBT side. So these people have an agenda and it's up to us to understand what the agenda is.
I'm sure it comes as no surprise that he is not well liked by the LGBTQ community. He is most famous on the internet for his outlandish takes regarding race and his arguments with well-liked figures regarding them. Nasheed is known for having a website documenting suspected white supremacists called the Suspected Words Database, which hilariously has a logo suspiciously similar to a swastika, and despite his adamant and frankly desperate denials, got him ridiculed by his critics. But the strangest controversy surrounding Nasheed is that he is secretly some sort of government plant, and that he is not who he says he is. This stems from his apparent wealth that many cannot track an actual venue of coming in, his ability to appear on television and maintain a large online presence despite many delusional takes that have amassed thousands of haters.
Suspected white supremacists are very smart, so you got it.
Right. Thanks for joining us. I appreciate it.
And past posts from relatives indicating a last name of Sanders. There are online indications that one Marcus Sanders, from Detroit but living in Alabama, was arrested for drug conspiracy. However, when one of his partners was going to rat him out, Sanders allegedly killed him and took his place in the witness protection program, becoming a government plant known as Tariq Nasheed. Some think he's in the CIA and some think he's a plant monitoring drug trafficking, but many others think he's an idiot. He's probably just dumb, and there's a lot of other dumb people who believe what he says. It's all pretty ridiculous on its own without all those conspiracy theories. Maybe it's better to leave those to him. He seems to come up with some pretty creative ones. But onto his appearances on the podcast. On the No Jumper show, Tariq is able to plug his natural deodorant that goes back to the days of slavery, because only he could relate deodorant to slavery somehow, as well as a documentary on hip-hop, and to lament about the trolls and say that they wouldn't say anything to him in person because he's just so big.
Right, in person, right? They don't really pull up in person like that. They know better, because trolls are really cowards by definition, so they keep a lot of that stuff online, but they don't really pull up in person.
This could probably be because, one, he's irrelevant, and two, he's a psycho.
It's up to us to understand what the agenda is.
But I digress. Notably, the host for these episodes, Flacco, who presumably is there because Tariq didn't want to be interviewed by a white person, or as some Tariq fans claim, because Adam is also a closeted white supremacist, absolutely loves Tariq and finds him hilarious. And while many would share that sentiment, it's for a different reason, and not because he's a ridiculous person. Anyway, predictably, Tariq's new documentary will be attributing everything good to black people. And he describes how contributions from Latinos are actually less than some people would say. Given his history of amazingly accurate documentaries, there's no doubt that this one will be extremely trustworthy as well. Tariq claims that when he insults people for their intrinsic attributes, he's simply roasting them, and that roasting is a part of black culture dating back to slavery.
Oh, that's fair game roasting. People want to roast, and then when they lose the roast, they want to start crying foul.
Of course.
But part of the foundation of black American culture is roasting. We got that from playing the dozens.
Of course.
That comes out of slavery, and a part of the culture of roasting was to get the brothers and sisters' minds and their emotions together so when they go out in the world and they dealt with racism, it would roll off their backs.
Take a shot for every time Tariq Nasheed mentions slavery for an unrelated topic. You won't finish the podcast. Anyway, this is his justification for being insanely racist and homophobic on regular occurrences. These podcast appearances essentially allow Tariq to make his documentaries and himself seem more important and successful than they actually are, justify all of his wrongdoings through either racism or having a root in slavery, and make comments about current events that I'm sure have all of the enlightening nuance of the rest of his takes. Honestly, the podcast appearances are relatively innocuous, but simply his appearance on the No Jumper podcast signifies their desire to take advantage of widely controversial and hated figures to boost engagement. Someone who shares a shocking amount of similarities to Tariq has also made an appearance on the podcast a short time ago. He is also tall and old, also lies about his age, and has constantly engaged in racism, sexism, homophobia, and other forms of ignorance and hypocrisy while constantly excusing his own actions. A familiar face here, he is LowTierGod. LowTierGod, also known as Dale Wilson or DeLuan Sparrow, is a very recent guest that I have covered in my last video on this channel, and much of that video references his retelling of his life shown in that interview. In that interview, Adam22 sits by as LowTierGod retells many of his misdeeds and claims that he does not remember even saying many of the things he is criticized for, as well as that he was just a hothead when he was younger. In the past, Wilson has doxxed and harassed many of his critics, insulted people based on any number of intrinsic attributes, and been the subject of a number of other allegations and accusations, which were completely ignored in the interview. Additionally, when LowTierGod reflects on his insulting a physically disabled gamer who plays with his mouth that beat him in Street Fighter, Adam even chimes in, claiming that you have to work with what you got, when referencing an instance of himself doing that same thing.
But yeah, to this day, I still hear about it.
See, my thing is like, because I recently got in a little beef with a Chicago drill rapper, and he like dissed me. But this is a dude who like got shot in the head and like shows signs of it. So I immediately went to that. It's like, you know, which I understand, you know, it's kind of a low blow or whatever. But it's like, I just feel like if somebody has like a, something clearly wrong with them physically, people then are not able to perceive the fact that you dissing them is not any different than them dissing you. And like, yeah, granted, if you were to just go from nothing to dissing Krang or whatever, like that would be offensive. But if there was a reason for you to be attacking back, you got to work with what you got. And a lot of times a disability is what you got.
That's true. Everything's rebuttal. Like anything you see me say on the internet is rebuttal.
Wilson is an extremely controversial figure that is known for lying about many aspects of his life. But Adam22 does not challenge him on any of these accounts, and even facilitates him lying about his age.
How old are you now?
How old do you think I am?
29.
Let's go with it.
Yeah?
Yeah, let's go with it. Yeah.
As well as other instances of encouraging or justifying Wilson's deranged behaviors. If you want a more in-depth analysis of LowTierGod, check out my other video. But the focus here is that Adam22 is someone who will not question and may even endorse the degenerate behaviors of his guests in the past. A trend that is shown with rappers, gang members, and even internet personalities involved with the podcast. It is very apparent that throughout his history, Adam Grandmason has shown that he has no qualms with engaging in and encouraging morally bankrupt behaviors and figures, with his controversies involving sexual degeneracy, crime, and violence, and this has clearly bled into his choices of and interactions with guests. From false accusers and alleged sexual abusers to unhinged conspiracy theorists, it seems that, if it brings him attention, Adam has no problem with platforming and endorsing these people. And this nature of sacrificing his character for popularity extends to his own self-flagellating tendencies. He will do anything for views and money, and does not care who he has to kiss up to or broadcast to the world in order to do it. He'll even kiss up to the guy who just banged his wife if it gets him more Twitter engagement and draws attention to her OnlyFans video. And to be perfectly honest, this seems to have worked for him, and he has not been truly cancelled or arrested, and continues to make copious amounts of money coming from a wide variety of different streams. The many degenerates his brand has boosted and held up will continue to, in turn, bring him engagement. And though he remains an extremely controversial and widely hated figure, it is unclear if he will ever see any real and tangible backlash for his actions. As for Tariq Nasheed and LowTierGod, they have carved out their own communities for themselves. And with their online track record, it is apparent that the fans they have remaining will not be leaving for pretty much any reason. Lady SB has not made and hopefully will not make a mainstream career for herself, and will bask in the virality of being considered a piece of dung by the majority of the people who find her online. She will probably continue to lie and self-aggrandize to make herself seem cool, but only time will tell if she takes off as an artist. I know there are piles and piles of degenerates associated with the No Jumper brand, and I'm just scratching the surface with this video, but I wanted to cover some very interesting people I've seen in recent episodes being allowed to promote themselves, as well as the source of all the degeneracy himself. Thanks for watching, and as always, like the video if you liked it, dislike the video if you disliked it, and leave a comment with your thoughts below, as well as any topics you might want to see covered. Also, make sure to buck break that subscribe button to see the hidden colors of the... I don't know what I'm saying. Subscribe for more content. Alright, see ya.